The beginning, let me turn on the laser pointer.
Okay, great. So hello all, welcome all of you to another live problem solving session for the course Introduction to Semiconductor Devices, which is being conducted by Professor Naresh Imani from IIT Hyderabad. Just to introduce myself again, I am Soham Lakote, currently a fourth year PhD student at IISc Bangalore, working under Professor Gaurav Banerjee, and my research area is in the field of analog and RF circuits. So first of all, apologies for preponing the session because I won't be available between Tuesday to Sunday. I'm going to some remote location where internet is unfortunately not available. So I won't be able to take any live sessions. And I also assume that since this week's content was just released few days back, I'm also assuming that you guys have not seen all the lectures. So what we will do, since from the last two lectures I have been clearing few conceptual questions, we are solving really good conceptual questions. So this, for this particular lecture, we will be solving few good problems which are of very practical importance. Okay, so I hope that is not a problem anymore, and in the next session we will cover up few of the problems from the week 6 lecture. Okay, so for the sake of formality, this will be the session organization. We will be having first 50-60 minutes of session, then we will take a few minutes of break depending on how many questions are still remaining, and then we will resume our session. And all the recordings are uploaded on this YouTube channel. If you guys are not able to access the recordings, just let me know. I will share this link once again during the break. And in the description section of each and every video, you will see a link to the presentation folder where all the lecture notes are being uploaded. Okay, so now let's have a quick recap which is required to solve the questions, correct? So let me just turn on my pen. Yeah, so these are all the formulas that we will need to solve the today's lectures. Okay, so now first, according to the charge neutrality principle, you must have seen that this formula in the lecture materials, right? So Na into Xp is equal to Nd into Xn. You must have seen it. It is nothing but this Nd. So if you just take a PN junction and if you have the depletion region over here, so let's say this is P side, this is N side. So you know there will be immobile negative charges over here, and on the right side you will be having immobile positive charges. So this Xp and Xn are nothing but the width of the depletion region on each side. So it is nothing but the charge, according to the charge neutrality principle, you must have seen this formula. And so this formula also tells us that if the doping on one of the sides is extremely heavy, then the depletion region on that side will be very, very small compared to the other region. Okay, so for example, if let's say my ND is much, much greater than NA. Correct? If my ND is much, much greater than NA, then from this formula, right? From this formula, you can clearly see that XP, just a minute, yeah, just give me a second, yeah. So XP, okay, what is happening? Yeah, just give me a second, guys, some issues there, yeah. Yeah, so from here, if ND is equal to NA, this condition holds true, correct? Then XP will be what? Much, much greater than XN. Correct. So I hope this is very much clear to you. And now this second formula just tells you what is the magnitude of the electric field, that is the maximum electric field. So you know that if I draw for this particular PN junction, if I try to draw the electric field profile, then it will look something like this. Correct. I will get a point of Emax over here. This is exactly at the middle, exactly at the metallurgical junction. Correct. This is what? This is Xn and this is my Xp. So you must have seen the formula for maximum electric field, which is given in the lecture materials. And from here also, you can see that Nd into Xn is equal to Na into Xp. Correct? So I hope this is very much clear. For the third formula, you guys must have seen it at least 10 times now. This is a formula that we'll be using for the built-in potential. That is Kt by Q ln Na Nd upon Ni square. Correct? Now, for the next, going to the next formula. So now this formula at least tells us what will be the width of the depletion region. So for this particular case, width is nothing but Xp plus Xn. So what will be the numerical value for this width? This formula actually tells us that. Correct? And the last point, one of the last formulas that we'll be having is, if we know the width of the depletion region, then how to calculate the width of the depletion region on either side? That is this Xn and Xp. So these two formulas help us to tell that.
So in few of the numericals, you may be given this Xn, Xp, and you may be asked to calculate the total depletion region width, or reverse must be given. They may be telling you that the width of the depletion region is known, or they will give you some hint to calculate the width of the depletion region. And from there on, they will ask you to calculate the extent of depletion region on either side, that is on the P side as well and on the X side as well, on the N side as well. So we have to use the formula number 5. And just to modify the formula 4 a little bit, so this is how we are modifying it when we are actually applying some reverse bias across the PN junction, correct? So now what you can see from this formula is that as you apply more and more reverse bias across the PN junction, the width of the depletion region will also increase, correct? So this is a very simple thing that we have studied intuitively during the last time, as well as from the formula you can confirm the same thing, right? And now the next thing that we will be requiring is some formulas from the CV characteristics, that is the capacitance voltage characteristics of the PN junction, correct? And we will be talking mostly with respect to reverse bias, because you know that there exists two types of capacitance, right? There exists two types of capacitance. One is we call as depletion capacitance. Depletion capacitance, and another what we call as diffusion capacitance. Correct. So this depletion capacitance, it is dominated in the reverse bias region only, in the reverse bias. And this diffusion capacitance, we generally take it during the forward bias. And just to tell you the magnitude, so if I just denote it with C diff, and if I just denote this depletion capacitance with C diff, correct, then if I just tell you the rough magnitude, then the C diffusion will be at least something like 500 to 1000 times the C depletion capacitance. Okay, but note that we generally take this into account in forward bias only, correct? So if you just want to study about this into great depth, then I will highly recommend you to look into some of the derivations that have been given in the Donald-Niemann regarding the diffusion capacitance, and also study about the small signal model, how we draw the small signal model. So there you will see that in the forward bias, this diffusion capacitance will be present over there. Okay, so now we will be talking mostly about the reverse bias. So we are very much interested in the depletion or junction capacitance, correct? So now across the PN junction, across this PN junction, correct? So I have negative immobile charges, I have positive immobile charges. This is P side, this is N side, correct? And now I am applying a reverse bias. I am applying a reverse bias across this PN junction, correct? And this VR is there, and on top of it, I am applying a small deviation delta VR. Because of that delta VR, the depletion region width will either increase or either decrease depending on what is the sign of delta VR, whether delta VR is actually increasing the total reverse bias applied or whether it is decreasing, correct? So now what I have drawn over here, so this is the depletion region, correct? This diagram is again taken from the Donald-Niemann. So what you can see over here, that depending on this delta VR, there will be some change in the depletion region. There will be some change in the width of the depletion region, and that is being highlighted by these sections that you are seeing over here, correct? So corresponding to delta VR, now what will happen? See, if the depletion region increases, if depletion region width increases, that means I am introducing more immobile charges, more immobile charges, correct? So that is why you can see they have written it like plus DQ charge has been introduced now over here, and minus DQ charge has been introduced over here. Why minus DQ? Because charge neutrality has to hold true, correct? We cannot violate that principle. So now you must have seen this, what is exactly happening by applying this delta VR. So now what is actually happening over here? So now it is looking as if I have two metal plates over here. And now they are being separated by a certain distance, that is my W depletion. And you know there will be a capacitance associated with it. And how to calculate that? So you know this formula, C is equal to epsilon A by D. Correct? So D over here is nothing but the width of the depletion region. A, where is the A? So they have taken capacitance per unit area. Correct? So this formula that you are seeing over here, it's capacitance per unit area. So its unit will be something like picofarad per micrometer square or femtofarad per micrometer square, correct? Because it's a capacitance per unit area, correct? So now this A has been taken over here, and we are left with only epsilon by W. Correct. So now, what is our job? Our job is to, whenever they are asking us to find the capacitance, we have to first find the width of the depletion region. Once we get the width of the depletion region, only then we can find the capacitance per unit area. Correct. And you guys must be very familiar with this formula by now regarding how to calculate this junction capacitance. So you just put the formula for the width. Just a minute. Yeah. So you just put the formula for the width that I had shown you in the last slide. This formula I'm talking about. Correct. And you just put this formula over here, you will get the expression for the capacitance per unit area. Now the important thing to note over here, what happens? So I will just write what happens when VR is increased, that is reverse bias is increased. Correct. So when we increase the reverse bias, when I increase the reverse bias, the width of the depletion region increases. The width of the depletion region increases. If the width of the depletion region increases, that means the separation between the between these two charged areas, right? Just consider them as a metal plates as of now. So the distance between these two charged plates over here, it increases. If the distance between the two charged plates, just a minute, what is happening? Yeah, if the distance between two charged plates increase, then my capacitance has to fall off. Then my capacitance has to fall off, and this is what you are seeing from this formula. Correct. So it is making sense as of now. Correct. So these are a few sanity checks that we will be having. And just to tell you an analogy with the metal plate capacitor. Correct. So you have two parallel metal plates. Let's say there is some dielectric in between, and now you have connected it across the battery. Correct. So this plate will be positively charged. This plate will be negatively charged. Correct. Let's say this is Q. And let's say this is Q and this is V that I have, correct? If I increase this by delta V, if I increase this by delta V, then the corresponding Q over here has to increase by delta Q, and corresponding Q here has to decrease by minus delta Q. Why is it so? Because you know this relation, right? Q is equal to CV. This relation has to be satisfied across all the cases. This relation has to be satisfied, correct? So any change across this V, it should be satisfied with the corresponding increase or decrease in the Q. Correct. So now this delta Q on this metal plate, correct, and this minus delta Q were separated by this distance D. Correct. And that's why we got this C is equal to epsilon A by D. Correct. So what we are looking, if any change is applied across this V, if any perturbation, a small perturbation is there in this V, then the corresponding increase or decrease in the charge, by how much distance they are separated, so that distance is D over here. Correct. Now just come to this case in the Donald Newman's diagram. So this is my plate A. Now this is my plate B. Correct. Now what is actually happening? Any change that is delta Q and minus delta Q will happen. Just a minute. Let me just change the color of my pen so that it will be much better. Let's say green. Correct. So any change in corresponding to this delta V, it has to be accommodated at the end of the depletion region. Correct. At the end of this depletion region. Correct. Now this distance is separated by W dep. This distance is separated by W dep. So now this D will be replaced by W dep over here. Correct. I hope that is very much clear to you. And now coming to the one-sided case of the one-sided junctions. So this was the formula for the width of the depletion region. Now you know. Just a minute. Yeah. So this was the formula for the width of the depletion region. Correct. Now this is P plus. This is N. So that means Na is heavily doped compared to Nd. So if I just take 1 upon on both the sides, then 1 upon Na will be much, much lesser than 1 upon Nd. Correct? So if we use this condition in this formula, then you can see that the Na term has been dropped off from over here. So for one-sided junction, so the region which is very lessly doped, so that region, that doping density will come into the formula for the width of the depletion region. Correct. And from this W, using this formula, we get the capacitance per unit area. Correct. And if we just take 1 upon C square dash. Correct. Now what you will be able to see is a linear relation between 1 upon C square dash and VBI plus VR. This is very important. We will be using this in our numericals today. Correct. And the slope of this curve, 1 upon C square dash and VBI plus VR, it gives us the hint to find out the doping concentration, because this is Nd that is present over here. Correct. I hope till now it is very much clear to you. Now we will start solving the problems. Correct. Whatever basic concepts were required, we have already covered them now. So now let's start with problem number one over here. Correct. By the way, guys, if you have any doubts, then please feel free to poke me. I may not be able to read the chat section because I'm sharing the screen and I have made my presentation as a full screen. So I won't be able to read the chat. So if you have any doubts, please feel free to unmute yourself and poke me at any point. Okay. So now this is a problem taken from the Donald Neumann. The maximum electric field in a reverse bias gallium arsenide PN junction at T is equal to 300 Kelvin is to be limited to Emax is equal to 7.2 into 10 to the power 4 volts per centimeter square. Now we will see, once we solve the problem, we will see why we have to design this doping concentration and reverse voltage in such a manner that we are limiting the Emax, that is the maximum electric field. Correct. It is related to the breakdown voltage that we have seen. You must have seen about the breakdown voltage, Zener breakdown as well as the avalanche breakdown. So we don't want our PN junction to operate in the breakdown region because it actually hampers the reliability of the of your diode. Correct. So now let's see what they have given us. They have given the doping concentration of ND is equal to 5 into 10 to the power 15 and Na is equal to 3 into 10 to the power 16. Now they are asking us to determine the maximum reverse bias voltage. Correct. Okay. So now the first thing that they have given me is mod Emax. Mod Emax, correct. So from the first slide itself, let me go back over here. So from this first slide itself, I will take this formula of Emax over here, correct. So now let me just write that formula once again. So mod Emax is what? QND upon epsilon gallium arsenide, correct, into XL, right. So now what I can find from here, see, the doping concentrations have been given to me. ND I know, mod Emax I know. Of course, the epsilon of gallium arsenide, of course, this I know as well. I will give you this value. Okay. So now from here, I can calculate the value of Xn easily. From here, I can easily calculate the value of Xn. Correct. Now from this value of Xn, can I calculate the question that they have asked me? That is the maximum reverse bias voltage. Okay. So now we have to see the formula where we get this maximum reverse bias voltage. So at least I know that W, there exists a formula of W which is proportional to what? VBI plus VR. Correct. So now if I am able to calculate the W, then from this formula I can easily calculate the reverse bias voltage. This is VR. Correct. Now the only question remaining is, can I calculate the W from Xn? Of course I can easily calculate, because Xn is what? Na upon Na plus Nd times W. Xn is known to me from this formula. From this formula, I will calculate it. Correct. Now, NAND they have given to me. Just a minute. Somebody wants to join the call. Yeah, correct. So now, Xn, I can easily calculate from the Xn. Okay, just a minute. Yeah. Xn, I can easily calculate from the Xn using this formula, that is formula number 2. I can easily calculate the value of W as well. And from the value of W, using this relation, that is the relation between the width of the depletion region and the reverse bias voltage that I am applying, using this third formula, I can easily calculate the value of VR over here. So that is the flow that we are going to follow for this particular question. Correct. So now let's use this formula number 1 and try to calculate whatever they have asked. Correct. So now let's see. So now what they have given. So first of all, I will write this like Xn is equal to epsilon gallium arsenide, correct, into mod Emax divided by Q times Nd. Correct. So now if you let's try to substitute the values. Correct. So epsilon is nothing but your around 11.9 into 8.85 into 10 to the power minus 14, because this is the permittivity of the free space. Now mod Emax is what? 7.2 into 10 to the power 4. Just a minute, somebody wants to join. Yep. Correct. So the mod Emax value they have already given to me. What is the Q? 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19. Correct. And what is the value of ND? So the value of ND is nothing but 5 into 10 to the power 15 per centimeter cube. Correct. So if you just solve this value, then you will get the answer for Xn as 9.478 into 10 to the power minus 5 centimeter. Correct. See, this is Xn. This is the extent of the depletion region on the N side. So its unit should be centimeter. correct? So now I got the xn, correct? Now I will use the formula 2, correct? Use formula 2 to calculate the value of w. So how can I calculate the value of w? W will be nothing but na plus nd upon na times xn. Correct? Now what is the value of na plus nd? So na plus nd is nothing but 5 into 10 to the power 15 plus 3 into 10 to the power 16 divided by na. Na is what? 3 into 10 to the power 16. Correct? And xn we have just calculated. This is the value of xn. 9.478 into 10 to the power minus 5. Correct? So the value of w, right? The value of w that you will get after calculating from this is around 1.1057 micrometer. 1.1057 micrometer. This is the value of w that we got. Correct? Now the final step of the problem is remaining. And what is the final step of the problem? So let me just write the expression for w. Correct? So what is the expression for w? It is nothing but root of 2 epsilon by q into what? Vbi plus vr. Correct? Into 1 upon na plus 1 upon nd. Correct? Now what I have calculated? I have calculated the value of w. I know the value of epsilon. I know the value of q. I know the value of na. I know the value of nd. What about VBI? See, from the question, they have not given the value of VBI directly, but the values of ND and NA, they are known to me in the question. And do I know any formula which relates the value of built-in potential with the doping concentrations on the either side? Of course, I know the formula. What is the formula? VBI is nothing but KT by Q ln of NA ND upon NI square. Correct. This is a formula that I know for the built-in potential. So now from, let's say I highlight this as equation number 3 and highlight this as equation number 4. So to get value of Vr from the equation number 3, first of all, I have to solve the equation number 4 to get the value of this VBI. Only then I can proceed ahead with solving the equation number 3. Correct. So now let's start with the solving the equation number 4. Correct. From 4, correct, VBI will be what? So what will be the value of KT by Q? KT by Q is given at 300 Kelvin, correct? So this will be nothing but approximately 26 millivolts, correct? Now ln of Na into Nd. So Na into Nd is what? 3 into 10 to the power 16 into value of Nd is what? 5 into 10 to the power 15 upon Ni square. This is gallium arsenide, right? So Ni is 2 into 10 to the power 6. So now this is the value of VBI that I will get from here. And if you just calculate it, then this value you will be getting around 1.1673 volts. Correct? And just to give you some sanity check. So now this value. So what is the normal VBI value that you used to get for the silicon, right? So it will be something ranging between 0.6 to 0.8 volts. Between 0.6 to 0.8 volts for silicon. Correct? Now why did it increase for the case of gallium arsenide? Because your denominator, which has the Ni square term, it is less for your gallium arsenide. So if your denominator is decreased, then the total quantity will actually increase a lot. Correct? And that too, this is squared quantity. Correct. So I hope this VBI value is clear. So at least from the sanity check, we get to know that, okay, the VBI value should be at least higher compared to what we get for the SI generally. Correct. Now I got the value of VBI, whatever I wanted. Now I will substitute it in the formula number 3. Substitute in 3. Correct. Now the width. Correct. The width I must be already knowing. So what is the width that I have? No. So the width is about 1.1057 micro. 1.1057 into 10 to the power minus 4, because everything I have to convert it into centimeters, not in meters. Correct? And since there is a square root over here, correct, it is better to take the square on both the sides. Correct? So now this will be what? 2 into 11.9, just a minute, into 8.85 into 10 to the power minus 14. correct? Upon Q is what? 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19. Correct? What is the value of VBI? 1.1673 plus VR. This is the VR that I want to calculate. Correct? And 1 upon NA plus 1 upon ND. 1 upon 3 into 10 to the power 16 plus 1 upon 5 into 10 to the power 15. Correct? So, once I solve this complicated equation, correct? So, you have to cross multiply a lot of stuff and then divide by this quantity. After that, you will get this 1.1673 plus VR term. After taking this term on the left side, you will be able to get the value of VR. And that value of VR will be around 2.813 volts. Correct? So now what is this value of VR? Let's see. This is the maximum reverse bias voltage that I should apply to limit my electric field to this particular value. So this is what they have been asked. So it is like we are actually designing a diode and then they are actually, we are what we are doing. So whatever data they generally give in the data sheet, right? So do not exceed beyond this particular voltage or else your diode may break down. Correct? So this is actually this kind of problem that we will tell the user now that, hey, you have told me to limit the maximum electric field to this value. Now the limitation on the applied voltage, that is the voltage that you can apply across diode, should not exceed 2.8 volts in the reverse bias case. Correct? So only then I can ensure you that your diode will work properly and it will not go under the breakdown. Correct? Now, why does it matter so much? Why does it matter so much? Let's check. We have studied the junction breakdown, correct, in the week 5 lecture. So now let's actually understand the practical importance of this junction breakdown, correct? So now this is the MOSFET diagram that I have been showing you from the past two presentations, correct? You are able to see the N plus P junction over here. You are able to see N plus P junction again over here, correct? So these are the junctions that I have. Correct. Now, I will just give you an example of your Wi-Fi router that is present in your home. Let me just change the color of my pen. Yeah. So, this is a Wi-Fi router that is present in your home. Correct. And if you look at the specs, if you look at the specifications, then it is supposed to deliver a 16 dBm of output power. Now, what does this 16 dBm means? The 16 dBm power is nothing but 40 milliwatt number. Correct. So just ignore this dBm term if you don't know. This is nothing but the 40 milliwatts of power. And if I try to calculate like a voltage across a load. So for example, if I just try to, let's say I consider this is my load resistor. And what is the load resistor for the transmitter part? It is nothing but your antenna. Correct. These two stuff that you are seeing, these are your antennas. Correct. So now if I want to, if the power is given to me and load resistance is also 50 ohm that is given to me, correct? You must have seen all the antennas and all, we generally have the 50 ohm, we match it with the 50 ohm, correct? So the load resistor is 50 ohm and the power is also known to me, correct? So if you just calculate the voltage across it, that is peak to peak, then you will get around the value of 4 volt peak to peak, correct? Now, who is driving this antenna? Who is driving this antenna? So in the first presentation, I have shown you the diagram of the transmitter and receiver and I have shown you this, right? This is my power amplifier and this is the antenna that I have, correct? So this power amplifier, it is a job of the power amplifier to deliver this much power to the antenna, correct? So at the output of the power amplifier, I should get 4 volt peak to peak swing. I should get 4 volt peak to peak swing, correct? And now if I just give you a very, very basic topology of this power amplifier, you can just consider this as a common source amplifier. This is your MOSFET. If you are not familiar with the structure of the MOSFET, it is completely okay. You will be getting familiar in the next 2 weeks. Okay. So now this is the MOSFET that I have. And this is a basic common source amplifier that I have drawn over here. Now the voltage over here will reach 4 volt peak to peak. The voltage over here will reach 4 volt peak to peak. Now what is this? This is the drain node of the MOSFET. This is the drain node of the MOSFET. And now if I just draw a junction like this, correct? So this is my drain terminal over here, correct? And this is my body. My body is P-type. My drain is N-type. So I have got a one-sided N plus P junction like this, correct? And now what is the specs that have been given to me? That it should be able to handle this 4 volt peak to peak voltage. correct? Now, if this diode has not been designed to handle this 4 volt peak to peak, then there will be a breakdown across this drain to body junction, correct? And this diode will be operating under the breakdown and it will completely hamper the operation of your MOSFET, correct? So you have to ensure that this junction, that is this N plus P junction that is forming because of the structure of the MOSFET, it is able to handle this 4 volt peak to peak. From where did this 4 volt peak to peak came? It came from the specification of your Wi-Fi router, that it has to emit 40 milliwatt of power across the antenna, that is this 50 ohm load, correct? And now you come to see the importance of this question, correct? So they have asked us to limit the electric field and they have asked us to determine the maximum reverse bias voltage, correct? See, this is the diode that we don't want to forward bias. This is the diode that we want to operate it as a reverse bias voltage, because this device is not a diode, this is a MOSFET. These are the diodes that are forming actually, and I don't want them to be in the forward bias, correct? Now I hope why the last question was so important. It just told you that what is the maximum voltage that you can limit your drain to body junction of your MOSFET, that it still won't go into the breakdown and it will still be able to handle the swing that your Wi-Fi router actually demands from your power amplifier. Correct? I hope that question, that concept was very, very clear, and why the question that I had just solved, it matters a lot from the practical point of view. Correct? I hope that is very, very clear to you. So now I will be going on to the next question. If you guys have any doubts, please feel free to poke me at any point. Okay? So now this is a very easy question, and I need some help from you guys to solve this question. Okay? So the energy band diagram has been given to me. Correct. This problem concerns the energy band diagram shown below for a diode under a bias. Correct. So now this is what they have given to me. Correct. And now what they are asking. So they are asking me, the first question is the diode forward bias or reverse bias? The next question is, what is the value of applied bias? And the third one is, what is the built-in potential of the junction? So I will just give you a little bit help over here. Correct. So now, first of all, tell me whether this diode is operating under equilibrium or whether it has been applied some bias. How will you check it? How we generally check it actually? Whether the diode has been applied under a bias or it is operating under equilibrium. How do we check it, guys? Whether the diode is actually applied under a bias or whether it is operating in the equilibrium. Guys, any hints? Harika, you want to say something?
It may be equilibrium, sir.
Equilibrium. Okay, how did you tell me that? How did you guess that it is under equilibrium? Any logic? How did you figure it out? Can you please tell me? Yeah, EI is there. Yeah, EI will always be there. That is true. EI will always be there. Okay, then. Okay, I will just give you one hint. There is something called as Fermi level and there is something called as quasi Fermi level. Do you know this stuff, right? Correct? So when do we use quasi Fermi levels? Yeah, that is okay. Under any bias condition, you take reverse bias, you take forward bias, or if you apply some external stimulus, that will be a much better word, right? External stimulus means if you shine the light on top of semiconductor, correct? So what does this mean? If the semiconductor's equilibrium has been disturbed, correct? If the semiconductor's equilibrium has been disturbed, then we use the concept of quasi Fermi levels. If not, then we say that the semiconductor material is under the equilibrium. And when the semiconductor material is in the equilibrium, we say that df by dx is zero. Fermi level is completely constant. in this particular problem, what you are seeing over here, they have broken down the Fermi levels into two different levels. Correct? So this is the concept of the quasi-Fermi level. Right? So if quasi-Fermi level is there, then that means some kind of external stimulus is there for this particular p-n junction. Correct? Now, can this be a light? Light they have not mentioned anywhere. They have just mentioned, just tell me whether this is forward bias or reverse bias. Correct? So that means they have been applying some bias across this p-n junction. Only then this semiconductor's equilibrium will be disturbed. If the semiconductor's equilibrium is disturbed, then I have to use a concept of quasi-Fermi levels, and that is what they have shown in this picture. Correct? So at least we know that some bias has been applied across this semiconductor. Now, how to actually check whether the junction is forward bias or reverse bias? Then we have seen that there is this one gap between the two Fermi, between the two quasi-Fermi levels, and then there is this particular gap. Correct? So now this gap, if you are very familiar, then this gap is directly related to what? Vr. So this is Q times Vr. Very good. This is Q times Vr. And what is this gap? This is Q times Vbi plus or minus Vr. I don't know because they have not given me whether this junction is forward bias or reverse bias. Correct? So from this diagram at least, we can easily tell that what is this QVR? This QVR is nothing but this gap between this 0.5 and 1 EV. Correct? So that means I easily know that my VR is now 0.5 volts. Correct? My VR is now 0.5 volts. And now if I look over here for this particular case, this is 1.25. This is 1.25 electron volt. This is 1.5 electron volt. So this quantity that you are seeing over here, so this quantity is what? 0.25 electron volts. Correct? Even though I had applied a bias of 0.5 volt, this gap that you are seeing over here, that is the reduction, that is the total built-in potential barrier that is present even after applying the bias. Now, can you please tell me whether the built-in potential barrier reduces under the forward bias or whether it increases? It reduces in forward bias. Very good. So, if now this has been reduced now. So, how did I say that? Because, see, I had already applied a VR voltage, correct? If it was a completely a case of the reverse bias, correct? If it was a completely a case of the reverse bias, then this barrier should have been increased, correct? This barrier is just 0.25 electron volts now. This barrier is just 0.25 electron volts now. The voltage that I have applied is already 0.5 volts. It is already 0.5 volts, correct? So if it would have been a reverse bias case, correct? Then this value, this quantity, let's say this quantity is X, correct? If reverse bias, then the quantity X should have been greater than 0.5 volts. Why did I say that? Because quantity X is nothing but sum of VBI plus VR. Can built-in potential be negative in any particular case? Have you seen negative built-in potential? No, right? Correct? So that means this VBI cannot be negative. I'm just asking about this VBI. That is this quantity. KT by Q ln of NAND upon NI square. Correct? This quantity we have never seen it to be negative. Correct? So what does this mean? If this was reverse bias, then the value of X should have been this 0.5 volt plus some built-in potential. That is why I was telling that for the reverse bias case, this value should have been greater than 0.5 volt. But now this value has actually reduced. Correct? And now, just now you have told me that for the case of the forward bias, actually the total... So for the case of the forward bias, this total barrier actually reduces. Correct? So my applied voltage is 0.5 volt. And after applying this, my total barrier has been reduced now. Correct? So that means this is a clear-cut case of the diode applying under the forward bias. I hope it is very, very clear to you. Guys, very good. Correct? Any doubts till this particular point? No? Very good. Okay. So what does this mean? So I have been applying 0.5 volts externally. Correct? Now, what is this? So this is the forward bias voltage that I'm actually applying. correct? So this is a forward bias voltage that I am actually applying. So I have two equations with me. So that means V applied is 0.5 volts. V applied is 0.5 volts. And since I am applying a forward bias, this potential barrier will reduce now. Correct? So now VBI minus V applied is what? 0.25 volts. Correct? Now if I just substitute it over here, so V built in potential will be what? 0.5 plus 0.25. 0.5 plus 0.25, so VBI will be what? 0.75 volts. Correct? I hope it is very much clear to you. So first we solve this question that the diode is indeed under the forward bias. What is the value of applied bias? So the applied bias value is nothing but the difference between the two quasi Fermi levels. Correct? So now we found out that it was around what? 0.5 volts. And now what is the built-in potential for the junction? So this is what we have calculated. So the built-in potential is around 0.75 volts. Correct? So I hope this was a very easy question and I hope everything is clear till this point. If you guys have any doubt, then please feel free to poke me at any point. Okay? I will be moving on with the next question and this is related to the CV characteristics. Correct? So now let's see what they have asked. Again, it has been taken from the exercise problem of Donald Neumann. The experimentally measured junction capacitance. Junction capacitance means we are actually talking about the depletion capacitance, correct? See depletion, and this is under for the case of the reverse bias only, correct? Of a one-sided silicon N plus P junction, biased at VR equal to 3 volt and T is equal to 300 Kelvin is given as 0.105 picofarads, correct? The built-in potential barrier is found out to be VBI is equal to what? 0.765 volts. The cross-sectional area has been given to me as 10 to the power minus 5 centimeter square. Find out the doping concentration. Okay, so now first of all, I have to see what is the formula for the junction capacitance, that is the depletion capacitance, correct? So while revising the concepts, we have seen this formula 1 upon C dash square is equal to what? 2 times VBI plus VR, correct? Divided by what? Q times epsilon s into Na. Now I have to check whether I have sufficient information with me to calculate the doping concentration Na from here. Correct? So C has been given to me. Correct? But in this equation, C dash is present, not C is present. Correct? So do I know the cross sectional area to find the capacitance per unit area? Of course, C has been given to me and area has also been given to me. Correct? So I can find out the value of C dash from here. What about the value of VBI and VR? So the value of VBI is given to me. Value of VR is also given to me. The value of Q I know. Value of epsilon also I know. Correct? Because it is mentioned as silicon. Then from here, I can easily calculate the value of Na. Correct? So now let's see. Let's calculate this value first. After that, I will ask you how to calculate the other doping concentration. Okay, so now first of all, what I need the value of C dash. So first of all, let me just denote it with equation number 1. C dash is what? C dash is nothing but C upon A. Just a minute. C is what? 0.105 picofarad, that is 10 to the power minus 12 upon A. A is around 10 to the power minus 5. Correct? So value of C dash, right? If you just find out, then the C dash will come out to be around 0.105 into 10 to the power minus 7 farad per centimeter square. This is the value of C dash that I have. So let me denote it with equation number 2. Correct? So now we will start substituting everything in equation number 1. Correct? From 2 and 1. Correct? So now 1 upon 0.105 into 10 to the power minus 7 whole square. Okay, somebody wants to join, just give me a minute. Correct. So now this will be what? 2 times VBI has been given to me as 0.765, the VR has been given to me as 3, Q is what? 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19. Correct. Epsilon is what? 11.9 into 8.85 into 10 to the power minus 14, that is the permittivity of the free space, correct, into Na.
If you look at this equation carefully, only this term is unknown. Only this Na term is unknown and rest everything you know, correct? So, you have to use your scientific calculator and just have to do this calculation, correct? So, after doing it, you will see that the value of Na that you will be getting is 4.9267 into 10 to the power 15 per centimeter cube. So, this is the concentration of Na that I got from here. Let me highlight it as equation number 3. Now, I will take a little bit help from you guys. See, I have already calculated the value of Na, but now I want to calculate the value of Nd as well. How can I calculate the value of Nd from here, from whatever has been given in the question? How can I proceed ahead to calculate the value of Nd? I want some hint from you guys. Mass action law. Let's do that. Yeah. So let's say this is my P side, this is my N side. Correct? So the concentration over here is Na. Okay, I will just draw the depletion region also, just for the sake. Just a minute. Yeah. Minus. Just a minute. Negative. This is positive. This is positive. This is Nd. Correct? So now if I use the law of mass action, can I do this? Na times Nd is equal to Ni square. Can I do this? What do you think, guys? Can I do this? So I will just highlight few points over here. Just a minute. PN junction is under bias. Correct? So that means equilibrium has been disturbed. Correct? So that is the first point that I wanted you to know. The second point, even if you consider that the far away from the depletion region, that is far away. So this is the junction, right? So if I try it from here, right? If I try to write law of mass action over here. Okay, just a minute. What just happened? Oh, internet issue. Just a minute. Guys, are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sorry, there was some internet outage issue. Just give me a second. So I have just highlighted this point. So I was just talking about this point only, that PN junction is under bias, correct? So equilibrium of the PN junction has been disturbed. Even if I consider far away from the depletion region, right? So that means, let's say this is my diffusion length. Diffusion length of what? Diffusion length of minority carriers. Correct? So far away from the junction and far away from this diffusion length. Even if I try to apply a law of mass action over here. Correct? So this is Nd and now this is Na. So now if I write for this particular part, Nd. Correct? Nd. And now this is what? This is a concentration of N type. So now concentration of P type I have to write. Correct? So now the concentration of holes on the N side, correct? This is representing where is that concentration. That concentration is of N side. And now whose concentration? The concentration of holes. Now this will be Ni square. If I write the law of mass action for this particular section over here, then the concentration of P is Na. Concentration of N is what? The concentration of electrons on the P side. This is equal to Ni square. Correct? So now, this equation is valid and also this equation is valid. Correct? So now what about this equation? Can you guys now tell me whether this equation holds true or not? Product of Na into Nd is Ni square. We are multiplying the whole concentration on the first semiconductor slab, multiplying the concentration of electrons on another region. So this Na concentration is present in this region. This Nd concentration is present in this region. Correct? We write this law of mass action in the p-n junction at any particular point. So you just cannot do a concentration of electrons here, concentration of holes here, then multiply them together, equate them to Ni square. This is not at all valid. Correct?
Yes.
Yeah, very good. So now another approach to solve, to check whether this is true or not. VBI is what? KT by Q ln of Nd, very good, upon Ni square. Correct? Now if I equate Na into Nd is equal to Ni square, what will happen? KT by Q ln of 1. Correct? Now this will come out to be 0. Correct? Again, this is giving me an absurd result. Correct? So logically also it is not making sense, and numerically also it is not making a good amount of sense over here. Correct? Now please tell me, how can I find the concentration of Nd if the concentration of Na is known? Just see what values have been given over here. Can I use any formula to calculate the value of Nd from here? Any equation that you suggest? That would not be here, correct? So electric field equation, so I have to use, but that electric field has not been given to me. Can I use any of these equations that have been given, values that have been given over here? Exactly, very good, very good. So this formula at least I know, right? VBI is what? KT by Q ln of Na Nd upon Ni square. Ni is known to me. Na I have already calculated. The value of KT by Q for a particular temperature is known to me. The built-in potential has been given to me. The only term that has been left which is not known to me is this Nd value. Correct? So from here, I will be able to calculate the value of Nd. Correct? So now let's try to calculate the value of Nd from here. So now VBI is what? So first of all, I will do one thing. I will take exponential on both the sides to make this equation look better. So what I will do, I will just write it like Q VBI upon KT is equal to what? Ln of NND upon Ni square. Now I will take exponential on both the sides. E to the power Q VBI by KT is equal to what? NND upon Ni square. Correct? So now if I just write the equation in terms of the ND which is unknown to me, ND will be what? Ni square by Na exponential of Q VBI by KT. Now let's try to find out its value. Correct? So what is the value of Ni? Just let me look at the junction. It is a silicon junction. Correct? 1.5 into 10 to the power 10 whole square upon value of Na. Na I had just calculated, right? 4.9 into 10 to the power 15. 4.9 into 10 to the power 15 into exponential of, what is the value of VBI they have given to me? 0.765. 0.765. What is the value of KT by Q? 0.0259. So you have to use this equation. And now the moment you solve this equation, the value of ND that you will be getting is what? 3.07 into 10 to the power 17 per centimeter cube. So very good. Now we have found out whatever they have asked to me. So first of all, we calculated the value of Na. from this 1 upon c square and VBI plus VR relation. And from after there on, we use the equation of the built-in potential to calculate the doping concentration of another site. And we also saw a reason, right, why Na into Nd is equal to Ni square won't be true. Correct? For any particular, for any case. Okay, I hope this particular question was very much clear. Now, we will be moving on to a very, very interesting problem from the unsolved exercise of Donald Neumann. Correct? And this problem deals with the concept of the oscillator. Correct? Not only, we are not going to study the design of oscillator and all. We will see what we have studied in the previous 2 weeks lecture to solve that particular question. Correct? So now first, let's understand when you are using the FM radio in your car, how does it actually even operate? Correct? So now I'm not going into the details of this circuit. So this circuit, it is called as a super heterodyne receiver. Correct? And now you will study this in your course called as analog communication. Analog communication. So this radio will be present in your car. What you are doing, you are just using this knob to tune into whatever station you want. Correct? And what are the very common FM radio stations that we have in India? This is Radio Mirchi 98.3. We have 91.1. We have 92.7, we have 93.5. So these are very, very common. Correct? Now what you are actually trying to do is that all these frequencies, right? 98.3 megahertz. So all these names are corresponding to a megahertz frequency. That is 92.7 corresponds to 92.7 megahertz. Correct? So whatever information, whatever song they are playing, actually that song is being carried out by this particular carrier. Correct? By this particular, that particular carrier has been assigned to those stations, and on this particular frequency, around this particular frequency only, whatever song they want to play, it is going on currently, right? So now what your antenna actually sees, your antenna is supposed to receive all these signals, correct? Your antenna should be wide enough that it is able to capture all of these signals. Correct. Now what I want, if I want to select, let's say 104.8 megahertz frequency to tune into this particular station. Correct. This station actually generally plays old songs, right? When your mom and dad were young, so whatever songs they used to listen, so this station plays those songs only. Correct. So now if you want to tune into this particular station, now what you have to do? So now you have to adjust the frequency of your oscillator that is present in your receiver, such that it is just 104.8 plus some offset frequency. Correct? Now if I want to select 98.3, then your oscillator has to change its frequency to a value 98.3 megahertz plus some offset frequency FIF. Now why certain offset frequency, and why not convert directly to why not directly use this particular frequency? This reason you will get when you will study this course, analog communication. Or if you are very, very curious, just Google this term, the super heterodyne receiver, and you will get the answer. Correct? I'm not going into that because it is completely out of the scope of this course. Correct? But at least you know that to tune into this different station, there is a need. There is a need for me to have an oscillator whose frequency I can easily tune. Correct? Because these are just few FM stations that I'm just showing you. There may be many, many different stations that may exist. Correct. Since I'm staying in Mumbai, I have just given you these stations which I listen to frequently when I'm in the car. Correct. So now at least this example is telling you that I will just write, there is a need to tune the frequency of the oscillator. Correct. And why tuning? I cannot have 9 or 10 different oscillator just for this station, because see, this frequency is not very huge, correct? So if you try to calculate the size of the inductor and capacitor required at this particular frequency, they will be very, very bulky. So already whatever oscillator you are trying to design, its inductance and capacitance are going to be bulky. Now just try to imagine, if you try to place 7 or 8 oscillators like that, it will take up a lot of area. Correct. So that is not the appropriate solution. That's why I need to have some circuitry with me which can help me to tune the frequency of the oscillator. Correct. Now this is what the question in the Donald Neumann is regarding about. So now let's look at the very basic oscillator. Correct. what we have a LC oscillator. Correct? We have LC oscillator. And can anyone please tell me what is the oscillation frequency of this LC oscillator from your class 11th and 12th physics? Correct. Very good. 1 upon 2 pi root LC. Now, this is my oscillation frequency of this oscillator. Correct. Now, if I want to tune the F oscillator, if I want to tune it, either I have to tune the inductance or I have to tune the capacitance, right? This is what this equation is telling me. Now, tuning inductance is extremely hard. It is very, very hard. If you study some circuit related courses, you will easily get that feel that tuning inductance is really, really hard. Correct. Now, what about the capacitance? Correct. Can I tune it easily? So now we have studied the PN junction, correct? We have studied the PN junction. And now we have also seen what happens when we apply reverse bias across a PN junction. Correct? What happens? The width of the depletion region increases. It is proportional to what? Root of VBI plus VR. Root of VBI plus VR. Sorry for the bad handwriting. Yeah. And what is the capacitance, the depletion capacitance? It is proportional to what? Epsilon by W. It is epsilon by W. So what did I get? C is proportional to root of 1 upon root of VBI plus VR. Correct? Now, if I can tune the reverse bias voltage continuously, correct? If I can tune this reverse bias voltage continuously, the capacitance across this PN junction will be tuning in proportional manner, that is inverse proportional manner. And if I am able to tune this capacitance, then my oscillation frequency will also change. Correct? So what can I do? So I can have some arrangement like this. Correct? I can place a PN junction. Correct? Of course, I will be having some reverse bias voltage across it. Correct? Correct? I can use something like this. Correct? Or maybe in a better manner will be to just ground this node and then apply this voltage across here to just to make this stuff easy. Correct? So now what we can see that we can get a continuous tuning of this capacitance if I just replace the normal capacitor with this PN junction capacitance that I get under the reverse bias. And if I put it across in a parallel manner across this inductance, then I can easily tune the F oscillation. Correct? And if I can tune the oscillator frequency, correct, then that means I have the capability to tune into different radio FM stations that I actually want to hear. Correct. So I hope till this point the concept is very much clear to you. Correct. Is there any doubt in this particular concept? Like, how are we going to achieve the variable oscillation frequency? Any doubt till this point? No? Okay, great. So, by the way, guys, do you want a short 2-3 minutes break or we should resume the session? What do you think? Do you want a small break, 2-3 minute break? Okay. Let's take a break and let's start at 7:16 p.m. sharp. Okay. Let me just stop it. Great. So we are good to go. Yeah, so we are talking about this problem, right? How are we going to have the tunability in the oscillation frequency so that we can tune into different FM radio stations, correct? So now let's look at the interesting problem from the Donald Neumann's book. So this is a problem. This has been taken from the unsolved exercise problems of Donald Neumann. Now let's look at this problem. An abrupt silicon PN junction at T is equal to 300 Kelvin is uniformly doped with Na is equal to 2 into 10 to the power 17 per centimeter cube and Nd is equal to 5 into 10 to the power 15 per centimeter cube. The cross-sectional area of the PN junction has been given to me as 8 into 10 to the power minus 4 per centimeter, 8 into 10 to the power minus 4 centimeter square. An inductance is placed in parallel with the PN junction. Correct? So now the first thing that they are asking me, with a reverse bias voltage of 10 volt applied across the PN junction, the resonant frequency of the circuit is 1.25 megahertz. Now they are asking me what is the value of inductance. Correct. So now let's look at the approach, how we can solve this particular question. First of all, they have given me the oscillation frequency. Correct. and you guys only suggested me this formula, 1 upon 2 pi root LC. Correct? So now the oscillation frequency has been given to me. Only things unknown are L and C. Correct? So now the first thing is L is the thing that I want to know. This is what has been asked in the question. Correct? So what does this mean? If I can find out the value of C, my question, at least my first question will be solved. Correct? So, but the value of C is not given to me. So now I have to see how can I find the value of this capacitance. C is what? Epsilon SI A by W. Correct? Epsilon SI is known to me. The cross sectional area is known to me. But the width of the depletion region is not known to me. So let's say this is equation number 1. Let's say this is equation number 2. So from the equation 1, the requirement was to find out the value of C. From the equation number 2, now that requirement, since the value of C, we are asking to find out the value of C, that corresponds to finding the value of this W. Because everything in the equation number 2 is known to me. Correct? So now the requirement to find out the value of C translated into requirement of finding the value of W. Correct? Now we will write the equation for the depletion region of the width of the depletion region to see whether we can find out the value or not. Now what is the equation for this W? 2 epsilon SI by Q VBI plus VR, correct, 1 upon NA plus 1 upon ND. The doping concentrations have been given to me. Epsilon SI I know, Q also I know, correct. The value of the reverse bias voltage, which corresponds to a resonance frequency of 1.25 megahertz, has been given to me as 10 volts. So the value of VR is also known to me. Correct? The only stuff that is left now is to calculate the value of VBI. Correct? So from F oscillation, right, to find out the value of L, we first determined that we need to find out the value of C. From the value of C, we came to know that we need to know the value of W. From the equation of W, we came to know that we need to find out the value of VBI. Correct? Now, from the value of VBI, what is the formula for the VBI? VBI is what? KT by Q ln of NAND upon NI square. The doping concentrations have been given to me. This is the silicon. So, the value of NI is also known to me. And value of KT by Q is also known to me. Correct? Now we will go exactly in a reverse manner. Correct? So from VBI, we will substitute the value into the equation number 3. The value of W will be substituted back into the equation number 2. The value of capacitance that will be obtained from the equation number 2 will be substituted back in the equation number 1 to calculate the value of L from here. I hope the flow of the question is very much clear and how are we going to solve this question. Correct? I hope it is very, very clear. So now let's start calculating the value of VBI. Correct? So now VBI will be what? 0.0259 ln of NA into ND. So NA is 2 into 10 to the power 17. ND is what? 5 into 10 to the power 15 upon NI square. So NI is what? By default value 1.5 into 10 to the power 10 the whole square. So if you find out the value of VBI from here, correct? The value of VBI will be coming to be approximately 0.7543 volts. So this is the first thing that we got. Correct? So now let me highlight it as A. Correct? Now we will do one thing. Substitute equation number A in 3 so that we can find out the width of the depletion region. Correct. So I hope this is very much clear. Now let's move on to the next page so that we can start solving the remaining part of the problem. So W is what? Root of 2 epsilon of silicon, 11.9 permittivity of the free space is around 8.85. Just a minute, something happened with my stylus. Just give me a minute. Yeah. 8.85 into 10 to the power minus 14, right, divided by q is what? 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19. So this is root of 2 epsilon SI by Q. We have the term VBI plus VR. VR is 10, VB I had just found out, right? 0.7543. 0.7543 into 1 upon Na plus 1 upon Nd. Correct? 1 upon Na is what? 1 upon 2 into 10 to the power 17. 1 upon Nd. 1 upon 5 into 10 to the power 15. This is 10. Correct? Now, if you solve this complicated square root, right, you will get an answer and I will just write it directly. So, this will be coming out to be around 1.7 into 10 to the power minus 4 centimeter. So, this is the width of the depletion region that I got. Let me write it as equation number B. Now, what was our next plan? So, our next plan was to substitute back the value of W obtained from equation number 3 into the equation number 2 so that we can find out the value of depletion capacitance. Correct? Now let's try to evaluate the value of depletion capacitance. Substitute B in 2. Correct? So now what is equation number 2? Epsilon Si A by W. So now let's substitute it. Dielectric constant 11.9. Permittivity of free space 8.85 into 10 to the power minus 14. Correct? Into area. The cross-sectional area has been given as, let me see, 8 into 10 to the power minus 4. 8 into 10 to the power minus 4 is given. So, 8 into 10 to the power minus 4 upon the width that I have just calculated. 1.7 into 10 to the power minus 4. Correct? So, now if you just calculate the value of this C from here, it will be coming out to be around 4.95 picofarad. And this pico is nothing but 10 to the power minus 12, in case you are not familiar. Correct? Now we got the value of C from here. Let me highlight it as equation number C. Correct? Now what was our flow? So now we got the value of C from equation number 2. So now this value of C we will substitute in equation number 1. Correct? But first of all, F oscillation is given to me. Our purpose is to calculate the value of L from here. Correct? So now I have to rearrange the equation number 1 such that I will bring this inductance term on the left hand side and all the terms which are known to me will be kept on the right hand side only. Correct? So first let me rearrange the equation number 1. Rearrange 1. Okay? So how will I rearrange? F oscillation has been given as 1 upon 2 pi root LC. I will just take the square on both the sides, okay? F oscillation square is what? 1 upon 4 pi square L into C. Since I want to calculate the value of inductance, let me keep it on left hand side. L is what? 1 upon 4 pi square F oscillation square into C. Correct? And this is my modified equation, which I will be highlighting maybe with equation number 5. Correct? Now, what we will do, we will substitute this over here. Correct? We will substitute this value of C that we have obtained in equation number 5. I will just write it. Substitute C in equation number 5. So that we can get the value of inductance now. So let's try to solve this question now. Value of inductance is 1 upon 4 into pi square is 3.14 square, right? Into F oscillation square. F oscillation has been given as 1.25 megahertz. Correct? 1.25 into 10 to the power 6 square. Correct? So, F oscillation square is there and only the value of C is remaining to be substituted. So, now value of C I have already found out. 4.95 into 10 to the power minus 12. Correct. So we have substituted almost everything, and now if you just solve this calculation, then the value of L that you will be getting, it will be very close to around 3.275 nanohenry. So this is the value of inductance that we got. Just a minute, let me just see whether this is correct or not. Just a minute. Let me just check whether this unit of nanohenry is correct or not. I just don't want to get any wrong answers. Just a minute. No, this is not nano Henry, guys. This is a milli Henry. Just a minute. This is not nano Henry. This is milli Henry. This is not nano. Okay. You will be able to confirm it as well because see, this is 10 to the power 12, right? So from here, you will get the power of 10 to the power 12. You have 10 to the power minus 12 over here. Correct? And this is 3 square. Correct? So now this major 10 to the power 12 and 10 to the power minus 12 are already gone. So there is nothing extra that is left which can take this inductance term to nano Henry. Max to max, you will get milli Henry because you have some multiplication that is going on the bottom side. That is the denominator. Correct? So we got the value of inductance around 3.27 milli Henry. Okay? So now we will look. So first part of the problem is solved over here. Correct? If you guys have any doubts, then please feel free to poke me at any point. We will be moving on with the next part of this question. So the part number A has been solved over here. What is the value of inductance? Correct? Now the next question is, using the results of part A, that is the value of inductance, what is the resonant frequency if the reverse bias voltage is VR is equal to 1 volt and VR is equal to 5 volt? Correct? Now what I will do, I will just solve this question for VR is equal to 1 volt, and using the similar procedure, you can find out what will be the resonant frequency for this 5 volt. I will just leave this as a homework for this second part. That is the second part of the second question. We will solve the first part of the second question. The second part of the second question will be left as an exercise. Correct? So now let's try to see. Let's try to think what is actually happening. So we found out the value of L from here. Now the question has been reversed. Now they are changing the reverse bias. They are changing the reverse bias. They may want to tune up different station now. Correct? The different FM radio station. By the way, this resonant frequency that you are seeing, this does not correspond to any FM radio frequency. This is completely out of the FM radio band that has been assigned. So I'm just giving you an analogy. So whatever I am saying, just take it with a pinch of salt. Okay? So now they are changing the reverse bias now. Initially, that reverse bias was 10 volts. Now we are reducing it to 1 volt. So now they are asking us indirectly to calculate the capacitance when the reverse bias of applied across the PN junction has been reduced from 10 volts to 1 volt, and after calculating that capacitance, substitute it in the equation number 1 to calculate the new value of the oscillation frequency. Correct? I hope the flow of the question is very much clear. Correct? So now let's try to solve it. So now let's say this is part 2 of the question. Correct? So now we know that the W is directly proportional to root of VBI plus VR. Correct? You can see from this equation also. Correct? From this particular equation number 3 also, W is proportional to root of VBI plus VR. Correct? So now if I just write W1 square upon W2 square, correct? It will be what? It will be equal to VBI plus VR1 upon VBI plus VR2. Built-in potential won't change unless and until I change the material or I change my doping concentration. Correct? So that's why VBI will remain same over here. So now if I just write W2 in terms of W1, then it will be what? W2 is equal to W1 into square root of VR2 plus VBI upon VR1 plus VBI. Correct? Now why am I doing this? Because I don't want to use these complicated equations once again to find out the value of capacitance. I am trying to see if I know a capacitance at a particular reverse bias voltage. That is, if I know C1 at VR1, can I directly calculate C2 at VR2 or not using some kind of ratio analysis like this. Correct? So now let me do this. Let me calculate the value of W2 over here. And after that, we will go into calculating the value of C2. Correct? So W2 will be what? So W1, right? W1 will be the value of depletion region width at VR1. VR1 means what has been given in the question. That is the 10 volts. Correct? So let me just write it over here. VR1 is equal to 10 volts. And VR2 is the new question that they are asking. At 1 volt, tell me the value of the resonant frequency. Correct? So that means this will be our VR2 value now. VR2 will be 1 volt. And at this particular value, we will be calculating the capacitance. So for calculating the capacitance, I need to know the depletion region width at this particular reverse bias voltage. So when the reverse bias voltage was 10 volt, my width of the depletion region I have already calculated in the in the equation number B that is present over here. Correct? So W1 is what? 1.7 into 10 to the power minus 4 into root of VR2 is 1 volt. What is the value of VBI, guys? VBI we have already calculated as 0.7543, right? 0.7543 upon 10 plus 0.7543. Correct? So if you just calculate the value of W2 from here, right? Then you will get the value of W2 around 0.687 into 10 to the power minus 4 centimeter. See, this is a very big question. I would like to have some sanity check with me. Correct? So what is the sanity check that I will be applying? I know that if I increase the reverse bias voltage, when the reverse bias voltage increases, the width of the depletion region also increases. Now I have brought down my reverse bias voltage from 10 volt to 1 volt value. So ultimately the width of the depletion region has to go down. Correct? So you can see the width of the depletion region when the 10 volt reverse bias voltage was applied, it was around 1.7 into 10 to the power minus 4 centimeter. Now this value has decreased because I have reduced down my reverse bias voltage that I am applying across PN junction. So at least this answer is making a logical sense to me. Correct? So the sanity check has been confirmed. Correct? So now what we'll be doing now, we will be using the C. That is, the C is what? Epsilon A by W. So that means epsilon is constant. First of all, the area of the cross section is also constant. So C is inversely proportional to the W. Correct? So if I just write C2 by C1, it will be what? W1 by W2. Correct? I hope it is very much clear. And C2 will be C1 times W1 by W2. Correct? Now, let's substitute everything. So what was the value of C1 that I got? 4.95 picofarad. 4.95 picofarad into the ratio of W1 by W2. W1 is 1.7 into 10 to the power minus 4. Correct? Upon this recent value that I have calculated. 0.687 into 10 to the power minus 4. So 10 to the power minus 4, 10 to the power minus 4 is gone. And if you just calculate the value of C2 from here, C2 will be coming out to be around 12.245 picofarad. It is coming around 12.245 picofarad. Correct? Now let's use the formula of F oscillation. F oscillation nu is what? 1 upon 2 pi root LC. Correct? See, once the inductance value has been calculated, it won't change unless and until it has been mentioned in the question. Correct? Inductance value has been fixed and we have calculated that value. Only the C has been changed and I will denote it by C nu. Correct? So now this will be what? 1 upon 2 into 3.14 into root of, what is the value of inductance that we got from the question number 1? Just a minute. It was around 3.275 millihenry. 3.275 millihenry means 10 to the power minus 3. Correct? And what is the value of capacitance nu? C nu, this is our capacitance nu, correct? This is C nu. So it is 12.245 picofarad. 12.245 picofarad into 10 to the power minus 12. Correct? So now if you calculate the new value of the oscillation frequency, correct? So now this new value will be coming out to be around 0.795 megahertz. It will be coming out to be around 0.795 megahertz. Correct? Now again I want to apply some sanity check. Correct? Because F old they have given in the question was 1.25 megahertz. Correct? I want to check whether the new oscillation frequency should reduce with the decreased reverse bias voltage or not. Because VR2 is 1 volt and VR1 is 10 volt. Correct? So now let's apply the sanity checks. Correct? So as VR is reduced, correct, from where we reduce, from 10 volt to 1 volt we reduce. As VR is reduced, correct, as we have reduced the reverse bias, then the width of the depletion region, then the width of the depletion region has to go down. If the width of the depletion region goes down, then the capacitance, the depletion capacitance will actually go up, correct? And if this C value goes up, then my oscillation frequency should come down, correct? And this is what we got, correct? From 1.25 megahertz, our oscillation frequency reduced to around 0.795 megahertz, correct? So as we reduce the VR, our oscillation frequency should have been reduced, and this is what we also got in our answer as well, correct? So at least the sanity check is giving us the confirmation that our answer is at least making some kind of logical sense, correct? So guys, I will just stop here for 1 minute just to check if you guys have any doubts over here, because this was a very long question. So I will just stop here for 1 minute. Any doubts, any question till this point? Was this question clear, or it went completely above your head? Was it a bouncer? Okay, great. Good. Okay, so I guess now we will move on to the last question for today that came in the ECE GATE 2018 exam. Correct? Just give me a 1 second, okay? Just give me 1 second. Yeah, correct. So now let's look at what has been asked in the question, correct? A junction is made between P minus SI with the doping density of Na is equal to 10 to the power 15 and PSI. This is very, very weird. Why? Because we have studied the PN junction. We have studied PN plus P plus N. We have studied PIN also. The junction that has been mentioned in the question is P minus P junction. This is a little bit weird, right? We have never studied this kind of junction. Okay, so these junctions, right, where on both the sides you have the same type of dopant. Same type of dopant means either the N type on both the sides or either P type on both the sides with slight variation in their doping. Correct? With some variation in the doping. Correct? So these type of junctions are what we call as isotype junctions. This is what we call as isotype junction. Isotype means same type of doping on both the sides. I mean, same type of, the nature of the doping is same, either P or either N, with some variation in the doping concentration. Correct? So now the doping concentration has been given to me, and assume T is equal to 300 Kelvin. They are asking me to calculate the magnitude of built-in potential across the junction. Okay? So now, see, whatever we have studied, those formulas may not apply over here. Correct? Because this is a completely new type of junction that we have not studied, and we are not even very sure whether can we apply the formula VBI is equal to KT by Q ln of Na ND upon Ni square. We are not even sure, because we always considered a PN junction when we use this type of formula, correct? So now whenever such type of question occurs where we don't have anything to start with, where the question is completely new and we cannot apply any formula, it is always the best option to go with the energy band diagrams, correct? So now let me just draw a energy band diagram before joining these two materials, correct? So now just guys help me with drawing the energy band diagram. This is EC EV, correct? I will also have an EC and EV over here, correct? So now let me write this is my P side. This is my PSI side, correct? And now this side is my P minus SI side, correct? So now if I denote, just give me a second, I will just change the color of my pen. In color should be maybe green will do the job. Yes, correct. So if I just write my Fermi level over here for this, correct? This is my intrinsic Fermi, and also this is my intrinsic Fermi. Just a minute, somebody wants to join the call. Yeah, so now I just have a doubt for this particular P minus SI. the concentration is what? 10 to the power 15. And over here, it is 10 to the power minus, it is 10 to the power 17. So, just tell me whether the EF for this particular case, that is P minus SI, should be above than this EF level or should be below than the EF level of the case where the doping is 10 to the power 17. Just to make a question little bit simpler, this is EF minus EV, let's say this is X, and let's say this is the EF minus EV over here, let's say this is Y. So can you guys please tell me whether the value of X will be smaller than Y or value of X should be greater than Y? I just want to draw a line of EF over here, but I'm not sure whether it should be below than the EF level of this or it should be above than the EF level of this. Y is less than X. Okay, so if the Y is less than X, that means the EF will be very very close to the EV. This is what you are saying?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so let's check whether this is true or not. Correct? So now we have seen that this concentration is around 10 to the power 15 and this is 10 to the power 17. Now if I just use a very basic equation, right? What do I mean by basic equation? So P, since this is a P-type material, right? P is equal to Ni times exponential of what? Ei minus Ef by KT. Correct? Now what I am saying over here is that the concentration that you are seeing over here, the P has been decreased now. Correct? The P has been decreased. So the difference of Ei minus Ef, correct? For this particular case, I will just write for the second case. So this is my second case and this is my first case. Correct? So the difference of Ei minus Ef for the second case, right? It is lesser. Correct? It is lesser than Ei minus Ef for the first case. Correct? I hope from this particular equation at least this much is true. Correct? So if the Ei minus Ef difference, correct, you can see over here, this is, let's say, I'm denoting it with maybe A1, and this Ei minus Ef, that one of you answered that Ef should be very close to Ev over here. Correct? Let's say I denote it with A2. Correct? Now this Ei minus Ef, so now from this equation, what we got, that this Ei minus Ef of the second case, that is A2, should be less than A1. Correct? This is what we got from this particular equation, that is A2 should be less than A1. But from here, what answer one of you told is A2 is seeming to be greater than A1. Correct? So the answer is actually opposite. The Fermi level should be above, not very close to EV. And it also makes sense, right? The more the Fermi level is closer to the valence band edge, that means the material is more heavily P-type doped compared to the first case. The more the Fermi level is away from the valence band edge, that means the concentration, that is the P-type doping, the concentration is lesser compared to the previous case, right? So that means the Fermi level has to be something like this. This is the Fermi level that I have. Correct? So now just give me a second. I will just erase something. Yeah, I will just erase this because this line is not at all required now. Correct? So now let me just get back to my pen. Correct? So now this is the diagram that we have for the energy band diagram before joining them. Correct? And you must have seen the procedure how we join these two band diagrams. Correct? So since they have not applied any bias, can you guys please tell me whether the Fermi level will be constant or we have to break it into two quasi Fermi levels? They have not applied any bias. Constant, very good. Because the semiconductor will be in equilibrium, correct? So now what we have to do, since this Fermi level, correct? Let me just change the color of my pen or else it will just become a complete circus. it should be blue now. Yeah, correct. So since the Fermi level has to be constant, right? The Fermi level on the left side is actually below, correct? And the Fermi level on the right side, it is actually above, correct? So now to make a Fermi level constant, correct? I have to push the right hand side downwards, correct? And I have to push this left hand side upwards so that the both the Fermi levels can match, correct? Now if you see that, if you push the left hand side upwards and you see this right hand side being pushed downwards, then you will see that you will get a slope like this, correct? Because this EC would have been at a higher level when you push this upward on the left hand side, and the EC on the right hand side would be at the downward energy level, correct? So this is the EC of the second case, this is the EC of the first case. So if I try to draw join them, then it will come something like this, correct? So now this slope, I hope this how we draw the energy band diagram after the joining is very much clear. Now we will draw the zoomed version of the second case, because the energy band diagrams before the joining are not of any importance to us as of while solving the question. So let me just join them, correct? This is how it will look. So I have EV, I have EC over here, I have EV, again EC is there, again EV is there, correct? And since the left side is heavily doped compared to the right side, the if I just try to draw the Fermi level, just give me a minute. Yeah, if I just try to draw, then it will look something like this. Correct? The Fermi level should be constant. This is how it will look. Correct? And if I just try to draw the EI, if I just try to draw the EI also, right? How it will look? Since the left side material, both of them are P type, correct? Both of them are actually P type. So you will observe that if you just draw the EI, then it will look something like this. It has to cross. It has to cross this value of EF, or else you won't be able to draw the energy band diagram at all. Correct? It has to cross something like this. So this is the EI. Note that the nature of the curve of EC, EV and EI, both of them are same. Because of the bad drawing, you may not be able to see that. Correct? So both the natures, this shape of this fall, the shape of this fall, the shape of this fall as well, everything is same, correct? Now what we have to see, we have to calculate the built-in potential. And what is the built-in potential? So you must have seen that we define this when the semiconductor is in the equilibrium. This is what our QVBI is. This is what our QVBI is, correct? Now why did I draw EI something like this? I told you that EI should cross this EF, or else the joining of the energy band diagram is not at all possible, correct? So if you just look at this difference, correct? If you just look at this difference and look at this difference, it has to be equal to this total band bending, correct? Correct? How did I say that? Let me just change the color of my pen again. If I just take maybe this time, I should take maybe blue, correct? Just a minute. Blue, right? So if I just take a horizontal line like this, correct? And if I project it like this, now this projection is also QVBI and this projection is also QVBI. This relation has to be satisfied, correct? That's why I told you that it has to cross something like this. That is, EI has to cross EF, correct? So now how can I write it? So I will write it something like this. QVBI will be what? So this is what? This is the first difference that I have, and this first difference I will write it like EI minus EF, correct, for the first case. This is EI minus EF for the first case, correct? This is, I only got this answer till now. I only got this answer. This answer I am yet to figure out, correct? And this difference is what? EF minus EI. This difference is what? EF minus EI for the second case. EF minus EI for the second case. Now a small question to you guys. A very small question. For the second case, if you just look at this particular section, correct? If you just look at this particular section, what you can see over here is that EF is actually greater than EI. Correct? So can you please tell me what is the characteristic of this material? When the Fermi level is above the intrinsic Fermi level, the material is N-type or P-type? N-type, very good. So now you can see that when we have joined the P-minus and P-junction, right? When we have joined, this is my P-type silicon and this is my P-minus type silicon. Actually, after joining this side, the second side actually became like a N-type material. Correct? So now, and why this was so important, you will understand it in a few minutes. So this was my equation number A. Now what I have to do, I have been given only the doping concentrations Na1 and Na2. I don't know the value of EI minus EF for both the cases, correct? So first of all, I have to write a relation which will tell me the EI minus EF in terms of the concentration. Do I know such relation? Of course I know. I know these relations, right? P is equal to Ni times exponential of EI minus EF by KT. Correct? I know this relation. Also, I know this relation. N is equal to Ni times exponential of EF minus EI by KT. Now, using these two relations, I have to simplify this equation in terms of the concentrations. Correct? So now, how can I do this? So EI minus EF of first, that is P type, that is a P type SI, right? I can write it something like this, correct? I can write it like KT ln of P naught 1 by Ni. P naught by Ni, correct? By the way, how did I write this equation? I wrote it from over here, correct? EI minus EF, this is what I want. So if I just take the log on both the sides, then log of P upon Ni will come on the left hand side, correct? And KT will come also over here on this side, correct? So I got KT ln of P naught 1 by Ni. Similarly, from this equation, what I will get, EF minus EI for the case number 2 will be what? KT ln of, correct, N naught 2 by Ni. So now what I will do now, this was equation number A. I will just write it as equation number B and I will just write it as equation number C. Correct? Oh, just a minute, what happened? Yeah. So now I will just write it from A, B and C. QVBI will be what? QVBI will be KT ln of, so when you add two logarithms, right, when you add two logarithms, they will be just getting multiplied with respect to each other. That is, the inside term of the logarithm will get multiplied with respect to each other. So this is what? P naught 1, correct, into N naught of 2 upon Ni into Ni will become what? Ni square, correct? So now if we just try to simplify it a little bit, correct, how will we simplify it? So let me just change the color of my pen, ink, maybe red will be better now. Yes. What is this quantity that is present over here?
Since this is an equilibrium condition, I can apply the law of mass action, correct? I can easily apply the law of mass action, right? So this, what is this quantity? N naught 2 upon Ni square, this is nothing but what? 1 upon P naught 2. I hope it is very clear. Only then this P into N will become Ni square. Correct? So now if I substitute it, QVBI will be what? KT log of P naught 1 upon P naught 2. And assuming that complete ionization has been taken place at a given temperature, this will be what? KT ln of Na1 upon Na2. Correct? This is what we got. So now, just rearranging the equation, VBI is what? KT by Q ln of Na1 upon Na2. So finally, from energy band diagram, we were able to derive the built-in potential equation for the case of isotype junction. And why did we derive it? We derived it because it was not a case of a PN junction. It was an isotype junction, that is P minus and P. We hadn't derived any formula for such type of junction. So we had to go back to the basics. That is how we derived the built-in potential for the PN junction. We have to go back to the basics, that is drawing the same energy band diagram and then deriving the built-in potential. And it came out to be just the ratio of Na1 upon Na2, that is inside the logarithm and multiplied by KT by Q. Now let's substitute the values. VBI will be what? 0.0259 log of Na1 is what? Na1 is the one which is having the higher side concentration, because this is P and this is P minus, correct? So 10 to the power 17 and this is 10 to the power 15. This is 10 to the power 17 and this is 10 to the power 15, correct? So now if you just solve this value, right? If you just solve it, then the value of VBI that you will be getting, it will be around 0.119 volts. Around 0.119 volts, correct? So now let's check whether the answer matches or not. 0.119 is very close to 0.12, right? So this is the answer that we got, correct? And just to tell you how you could have solved this question easily in the GATE exam, then the same question is present in the unsolved exercise of Donald Neumann. Just look at this problem number 7.12, an isotype step junction. What we have studied is also an isotype step junction. And just look at, this is the figure corresponding to the question that have been given. Correct? The only difference is they have given this N and N minus type isotype junction. The question that appeared in the GATE was P and P minus type isotype junction. Correct? So it is not that all the questions in the GATE exam will be so tricky that you won't be able to solve. That is why I always suggest that you should solve the reference book's unsolved example first, before trying to directly jumping onto the GATE exam questions, correct? Because if you solve all these questions, not all, but most of the questions from the unsolved exercises of Donald Neumann, I can give you a guarantee that you will find the GATE paper to be easy, at least for the semiconductor course. Not only for semiconductor, for any other course you take, if you solve the unsolved exercises of reference books that has been mentioned in your syllabus, most of the questions you will be able to solve in the GATE question or GATE exam without any trouble. Okay, so this was the last question for today, guys. We are already at 8 PM. If you guys have any doubts, then please let me know. Was this question clear? Was there any doubt in this particular question? Because this, it came in GATE 2018. Was there anything that you want me to repeat? You, any question that you didn't understand from all the 5 or 6 problems that we covered today? Any doubts, any questions? No? Okay, very good. Last call for doubts, guys, or else we'll just wrap up. Any doubts to any other people? Okay, guys, we'll wrap up the session. Thanks a lot for staying here for 2 hours. Have a great evening ahead, guys, and have a great days in this weekdays, upcoming days. Thanks a lot, guys, and have a great evening. Bye bye.